Hey everyone, thanks so much for joining me. Stitching with Sue here. Welcome, welcome, welcome. If you're brand new to my channel, I would like to welcome you here. Take a look, see if you like it. If you do, I'd love to have you as a subscriber to my channel. It's absolutely free. To subscribe, all you have to do is hit the subscribe block next to that. After you click on that, there'll be a series of bells that will show up. If you click the top bell, where it colors it all in, then that will give you notification when I upload new videos. And I think you will be pleasantly surprised. And you know, I'm just realizing right now, I don't have my microphone in, but we are not at the embroidery machine today. Let me just get my microphone here. I don't believe that my sewing machine. Hold on a sec. Let me plug in. Sewing machine makes quite as much noise as my embroidery machine, but just in case, there we go. Hopefully that's not going to be rubbing against my shirt. All right. So, and if you are a subscriber that has been here before, thanks so much for coming back. So what am I doing today? Well, it's been a week. Probably won't be able to go into all that. I'll try to go into what all has been happening in my life, but I needed to decompose. So I have been talking about rope balls, rope balls, rope balls. So I thought I would share with you how I do my rope balls. Now, there are many, many videos on YouTube, and you may have even seen them. Oops, sorry, I'm just snipping some threads. If you have, that's great. But right now, what this video is going to be is to do a basic rope ball, but I'm going to do coasters this time. So this part of the video will be coasters. Then I will attempt off camera to do some embroidery on it. So let me show you what I've been working on, trying to get myself acclimated back to rope balls. I've done rope balls before in the past. I can't tell you how long it's been, a few years, but let me share with you. Let me move you back a little bit. This is some rope that I found in my laundry room, and this is rope that let me zoom out a little bit. There we go. This is rope that I got. Let me see. Do I still have the paper? I got at the dollar store. I had it in my stash. I do. Here, hold on. Give me a moment. Let me go through here. And if I have the wrapping for it. I know I kind of ripped it off a little bit. Here we go. And I'll show you. You can get all kinds of rope. You know, you can get the colored rope. You can get your basic rope color. This one, well, part of it is kind of ripped off. You know, it's at the dollar store. Greenbrier. It's 3/16 of an inch. It was 25 feet. And I did the whole bit of it. I don't know where the other part of it is, but I think it's kind of cool because it's actually rope that has a pattern to it. So there's lots of rope you can get. And it's just a little bowl. It was my first try, and I put a little ending here with a little hoop on there. And my thinking is, with this is maybe do an embroidery piece and either stitch it or glue it in the bottom. I think that that would be fun for that one. So that was my first attempt after not doing rope balls for a while. Then I had gotten this rope from Amazon. It came in a 2-pack. It's just premium quality cotton rope. Comes with 50 feet. This is 3/16. What was that other one? The other one was what? 3/16, the same thickness. And you got two skeins of it, and it comes like this. Okay, so let me get this out of the way, and that, and let me show. I did The whole skein, I'm going to call it a skein. I had this little piece left. I'm thinking maybe I can do like a little bow and stick it on there or something, you know. I don't know. This is what's left from it. I don't know. Let me measure here for you. 7, 14, 21, about 28 inches is left. And here's the size bowl that I got out of that. I put little handles on. I know it's not the best. You can, if you want to embroider in here, what you need to do is don't do your sides. Make your bottom and then go ahead and take it to your embroidery machine and then go and embroider it and then come back and do your sides. So to do the sides, let me just explain a little bit. I'm going to show you how to do the basic bottom because I want to do some coasters. And then when you want to do the sides, all you're going to do is you're going to put it. Let me bring it kind of close. It's hard to share this. When you start going, you're going to take your bowl. Let me go maybe a little further back. And you're going to tip it up like this. Can you see that? See how that's tipped? Tip it up to the top here, and that's what's going to create the sides of your rope ball. So like I said, I'm going to make coasters out of this, so it's pretty much done. And I dropped my pin somewhere. I don't want it there. Oh, there it is. And it's pretty much, they're all started the same way. They're all done the same way. Whether you choose to do the embroidery or do embroidery separate and then stitch it in the center, totally up to you, depending on your rope, depending on your machine. If you don't think your machine can do it, then certainly you don't want to go ahead and ruin your machine at all. So let me just move this out of the way. I had to move some things in order to fit this on my stamp desk. So anyhow, I have a pin and let's get going. My machine is a, let me move you over here so you could see. It's a Singer Quantum Stylus 9960. I'm trying to think, where did I get it? I think I got it through Amazon. Now I have an older machine, and the other machine was, gosh, my daughter was very young when I had the other machine, but I thought it was time for an upgrade. I wanted this machine, I got this machine out a few years back. I wanted the one that like cut the thread. This one has tons of stitches in that. Not that I need them all, but mostly because it cut the thread and it was just a more modern machine. And it wasn't very expensive because you know me, I'm kind of cheap. I don't like to spend a whole lot of money. I'm just like the rest of you, you know, living on a budget. And now even so much so. So I'm kind of glad that I had got it when I got it. All right. So here's our rope. I'm just going to leave it. Let me move back a little bit. This is going to be so hard to share with you. It's a lot harder to share than the embroidery, that's for sure. So I took the end and I just snipped the end. And what you want to do is you want to tightly coil. Let me put my pin down. Tightly coil your end. Okay, get it like rolled up. Reminds me of those licorice wheels. I'm going to roll it up. And then I'm going to put a pin to hold this because we're going to want to stitch the center. And hopefully I won't yell out in pain if I poke myself here because I've already done that how many times today. All right, let's see. You want that to be fairly tight, okay? So it's going to get rolled up like a coil. Now, normally I would suggest not running over your pin. However, I just went real slow and I'm going to make a line this way back and forth, and then once that's secure, I'm going to take my pin out and I'm going to go here. So you're going to kind of make like a plus mark, and you're going to do this with a straight stitch. So I'm going to put a straight stitch. I have white thread in the top and white thread in the bobbin. Let me try to, I'm going to do my best, you know, to try to make this that you can see. I'm not really sure how all this is going to work, but anyhow, so I have it down like so. Maybe if I go a little higher, and I'm going to stitch straight. Okay, I'm going to go slow and I'm going to back up to secure it, and I'm going to go real slow. And I know I have that little piece hanging out. Let's cross our fingers and toes that we don't break our needle. Normally you would not run your needle over. Normally. Okay, I'm going to go to the end. I'm going to back up. So in the beginning, this is a little tedious. I want to be honest with you. I'm going to tell you it's a little tedious because of the fact that you're working with this little tiny circle. But it gets easier as the circle gets larger. All right, I'm going to go ahead and cut this. Lift this out. I'm going to take my pin out and I'm going to turn it. Now I have my glasses off because I see better without my glasses. Can you believe that? I did go to the doctor last week, and well, that's a whole other story, but I did get a new pair of glasses ordered. And you know how they tell you a week to two to get them. So I'm just doing a little cross to just to secure that center. Going back and forth. Okay, and I'm gonna cut that. And there we are. So it's a little circle. And what I want to do is I want to do some trimming of these threads that are here. Just so I don't end up getting them caught anywhere. Okay. Now I haven't used this machine too much as far as anything but straight stitching. So what you want to do when you're going to continue is you're going to change your thread. Well, you're going to change your, I apologize if my words don't come. I'll fill you in on that in a minute or so. You want to make a zigzag stitch. This is going to be a zigzag stitch. And you can adjust, you know, how wide you want your zigzag. I'm just going to hit zigzag and whatever the setting is, that's what I've been using. Okay, so you can see that. So now what you're going to be doing is you're going to have this on, let me see, is that the right way? Yeah, on the left. And I just have my whole spool skein of rope on the left hand side, and I'm going to put my needle down. Now when you're stitching, you're going to be stitching in between the two ropes that go together. So don't look at your needle. Look in between the two ropes. And when you first get started on this, it's going to be a little tedious because this is a small area. As the circle gets larger, it gets a little bit easier to go. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. So I'm going to push in the rope up against, let me turn this a little bit up against so that it's going. I'm hoping you can see this. It's just difficult to do. I'm pushing the rope up against the circle. Maybe once I get a little bit further, it'll be a little more easier to share the photo with you. All right, I'm just going to go back and forth, and I'm going to go slow. It's going to go slow in the beginning. And what I'm doing is where these two ropes are going to match, that's where I'm doing a zigzag. One on that side, one on that side. I hope that's all making sense to you. You don't want to push it too tight. If you do, what's going to happen is you're going to get like a bubble in the center. Let me try to turn it a little bit here. So you're just going to kind of ease it around. I see that big piece of thread here. I'm going to trim that. I hope you're able to see this. Let me see, maybe. I'm not sure how else I can do. I don't want to sew my finger. That's the one thing I don't want to do. And you can make this whatever size you want to make this. Whatever size, if you're going to do a bowl, you're going to do a coaster. So it's just going to kind of glide right along. It's getting a little bit easier now. If you find that you go off track, just kind of stop and trim your thread and just go back over it again. Another fun thing you can do with this is you can use variegated thread. That looks really, really cool. I've done that before in the past. I just used my machine embroidery thread for that. I didn't go out and buy any special thread. Just use machine embroidery. And here comes Miss Dory to say hello to everyone. And there she is. And here comes Miss Aurora too. I posted a picture of them the other day. So I hope you all got a chance to see that over on my Facebook page. If you're not a member of my Facebook page, it's on Facebook, of course, and it's Stitching with Sue. So if you're not yet a member, go ahead and head over there and join. I'm getting a little bit of a bubble. I'm just trying to hold that down. I'm trying to see if you could, I think you could see maybe as it gets a little bigger, but it's just basically doing zigzag back and forth. And I'm hoping to do, I would think I'd get a couple coasters out of this roll. And be able to, I want to attempt to do one off camera. If you're going to do embroidery on this, you don't want to get, turn it a little bit here. You don't want to choose an embroidery file that's too dense. If you have one that's too dense, I'm not sure how, you know, your embroidery machine, you know, we know our embroidery machines are our babies, right? We want to treat them with kid gloves. So if you feel that your what you want to embroider on your little rope basket or coaster is going to be too dense, you may want to just stitch it onto a piece of fabric and just attach it to the bottom of your basket. Whether you want to sew it with a straight stitch, or I probably would use a fabric glue, only because I'm just a little bit of a nervous Nelly. I know it's hard to believe, right? Stitching with Sue is a nervous Nelly. Yep, she is. Okay, so there you can see what it's looking like so far. I hope I'm making it clear enough. Now you can make this whatever size you want it to be. You want to make some kind of narrow basket. You know, it all goes with the size of what your base circle is going to be when you go to do your sides. You can make your sides as tall as you want. If you don't have enough rope on your skein, you can just go ahead and add in as you're stitching. Just continue and add another piece right in, and it'll all work out for you. Okay, I think that's looking really great. I'm really happy. And like I said, if I missed any place, I would just go right back in and just stitch right over that. So it just kind of coils. Just kind of coils around, just like this. It just coils around. Let me wiggle you back a little bit. Maybe that'll be a little bit better. Let me see here. So anyhow, as I'm doing this, I'm just going to go slow. Sometimes Sue can't do two things at one time. Who can relate to that, right? So I just want to fill you in a little bit. I'm just going to do a little bit of fill in. Next time I do an actual machine embroidery video, I could probably go into more detail. But I've been MIA. I went to a post-op visit last Monday with the surgeon that did my craniotomy. So if you're not following me and you're like, what? I have a brain tumor. And I had a craniotomy back in October and had that removed. And I have follow-ups and, you know, multiple physicians. It's cancerous. Cancer physician, surgeon, specialty eye, because my eyes were affected, that kind of thing. So I had an appointment the week before with a neuro-ophthalmologist who tested me. It's my second follow-up with her, and she's really nice. And she was testing me to see if I was going to be able to drive, because I have not driven since this whole thing happened back in October. And I passed. So I passed the driving test. I have a, on the bottom right in my vision, I have a depth perception problem. But it wasn't, you know, it's improved. It's, you know, never going to be 100%. Unfortunately, when cancer hits a certain area and kind of kills off a certain area, it leaves a black area. That part will not get better. But it's to the point that it, you know, it things improved a little bit. So I'm aware of that now, and according to the test that I did with her, I passed. So I was thrilled. So then she said, as far as it's okay with your other physicians, she's releasing me to drive. Now, I don't know how big my coaster is going to be. I think I might want to go a little bit larger. So I was thrilled. I couldn't tell you how thrilled I was. So last Monday, I had an appointment, post-op appointment with my surgeon that did the craniotomy. And he's really pleased how things turned out. I'm using the Optune unit. If you're not familiar with that, I'd suggest you go check it out. It's really amazing. It's a unit that kind of reminds me of like a Holter monitor that you wear. It has electrodes that lead to these sticky pads. Four sticky pads that go on the top of your head, and they release electrodes. And what that does is that the electrodes go and attack the cancer cells from reproducing. And the diagnosis I have is glioblastoma. There is no cure for it. They're always working, doing studies, trying to come out with a cure. All of us affected by this, it's a terminal illness. By the time you find out, it's a grade 4 illness, and there's really not too much you can do. But by using this Optune unit, it's going to, hopefully, what it's supposed to do is kill cancer cells from reproducing. So when like I had radiation and undergoing chemotherapy, those are great things to for cancer to kill cancer cells, but unfortunately those also kill good cells and bad cells, whereas Optune attacks the cancer cells. So I wear that thing 24/7, supposedly the rest of my life. And I don't know how big I want this to be. So anyhow, I went to the appointment. He was really happy with everything, and he said, you're okay to go, you're okay to drive. So that was Monday. I was so excited. I'm thinking, where's the first place I want to go? You know, where do I want to go? You know, I have everything delivered. I have my, thank God for my son. He lives local. He takes me to every appointment. He's the greatest thing since sliced bread. And I thank God every day that he brought him into my life because of that. I don't know. I'm thinking maybe my coaster is going to be large enough. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to snip it. I know it's frightening, isn't it? Okay. So anyhow, so that was Monday. Tuesday, I got up. I'm going to go a little bit. Now I have this end piece here. I'm going to tuck that end right underneath here. And I'm just going to stitch right over that. Okay, let me do this and then I can continue. I'm going to back up. I'm going to go slow. And then go forward. And that's going to secure the end of that rope. I'm going to go a little bit further. And cut that. And there we go. Well, that's zoomed in. Okay. Okay, and there it is. Let's look at the back. Here's the back. Okay. It's hard. It's secure. It's good. So there's number one. I have plenty left. I'm going to make another one. So while we're chit-chatting here, I'm very happy with that one. All right, let me find the end. So anyhow, Tuesday I woke up. I had my, my normal routine, if there is such a thing. Let me get that pin again. I'm going to do the same thing with this. I'm going to coil this. Okay. I'm going to coil it. So I got up and I showered and I forget. Oh, I came up and I was embroidering. And I was doing a beer mug rug for 4th of July. I thought my son's girlfriend, because she does so much for me to help me with changing the arrays. That's what the little things, the little sticky things that I have to put on my head, they have to be changed. And she's the one that does it, because they actually make like a map where the arrays have to go. And the map focuses on where your cancer is. Okay, I'm going to go back to straight stitch. And I'm going to make another one. This is really fun. This is really fun. I think anybody could pretty much do this. I mean, heck, I can do this. Anyone can do. So anyhow, I came upstairs and I was working on her mug rug on the embroidery machine. And I started, like, things kind of weren't, I don't know how to explain it. Things were kind of, like, weird. You know, I was trying to cut things, and things were kind of not really jiving right. And I thought, you know, I kind of felt a little strange. So I thought, well, you know, maybe I'm just hungry. I'm going to go down and have something to eat. I'm going to take the pin out like I did before. Put that in my other basket so I don't lose it. And I'm going to go this way now to make the X. So I went down and I just took a bagel and I didn't toast it or nothing. I'm like, I'm just going to eat the bagel plain with nothing. I do that a lot. Sometimes I just don't have the energy to even want to, you know, do a toaster bagel. So I ate the bagel and I'm like, I still kind of felt weird. Oh dear. That's what I didn't want to do. Okay. Notice that made me jump. Okay. I'm going to stop there. I'm going to figure that's enough for that. See, that's why you want to be careful. because, you know, you're going through all this thickness, but we'll be fine. Everything will be good. Let me just trim these threads. So I started not feeling well, and then I'm going to switch now to the zigzag stitch, and let's hope that things are going to be okay when I get going. I started not feeling well, and things were kind of progressing a little bit. And here's my little circle. Let me pull some of this. I'm going to start doing my zigzag again, okay? I'll start back here. So I thought, you know, I think I need to call my son and tell him, you know, something's not right. I'm not feeling right. Things aren't, you know, I don't know. Things just didn't feel right. So I opened my phone and... Sorry, this is the tedious part here. Open my phone and I'm like, I could not figure out how to call anyone. It was like my brain stopped functioning and stopped making sense. I just was totally confused. Getting a little bubble there in the center. I'm gonna hold that down. Totally confused. Thinking, oh my gosh, then panic was coming in, and I'm like, I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm trying to open it, I'm closing it, I'm opening, closing, I'm, you know, looking at, I'm trying to find the, you know, contact. I mean, nothing was making sense to me. While I was trying to do all that, in the meantime, the phone rang, and I answered it. Now, I get, because I can't drive, I get mobile lab comes to my house to do blood work. They've been coming the past every week. My blood levels have been low. My platelets, and there's another one that I don't remember what it's called, but there's another one that they've been low. So I cannot continue my oral chemo meds because of the numbers being too low. So it happened to be the woman calling to remind me that they are coming the next day. So this was Tuesday, so she was calling to remind me that they were coming on Wednesday for a blood draw. And I said to her, I said, you know, something's not right. I'm not feeling right. I don't know how to contact anyone. I don't know if I'm having a stroke. I don't know what I'm having. So she said, okay. She said, do you want me to call the ambulance? And you know me, ambulance. I don't need an ambulance. I'm not sick. Yeah, you know. So I was just like, I don't know. And that's pretty much what happened was, people would, you know, even, you know, I was asked questions and I didn't know. I didn't know how to answer the questions. I couldn't answer the questions. Couldn't make any sense out of anything. So she said, okay. She goes, I'm going to call the ambulance. She said, go and open your door so that when they come, they can get in. And she said, I'm going to call the ambulance for you. So I said, okay. I opened the door and I just sat on the couch and I waited and they came. She had called me back and said, you know, they're on their way. They're coming. And I said, okay. Because right now, like, I'm at the point where I'm like, you know, I don't know. I didn't know to cry, to scream. I didn't know what to do. So they came and long story short, they took me in the ambulance. I had lights and sirens. I had never been in an ambulance. Well, I was in an ambulance once before when this whole thing happened. They had to transport me to a different hospital, but it wasn't like I was on a litter and sick or anything. I was just strapped in a wheelchair in the back of an ambulance just to get a ride to another facility. But went to the ER, and, you know, right away, CAT scan, blah, blah, blah. So this was Tuesday. So they said, you know, nobody really said what all was going on, but they said, we're going to admit you for observation. So observation is, you know, observation, right? One night, right? That's what we would assume, one night. Well, one night turned into two, three, four nights. All sorts of tests, MRIs, EEGs. They thought that I had a seizure. It showed on the EEG that I had a seizure. I got to the point where I could not remember things. Short-term memory. I'm still kind of struggling a little bit with that, with words. And, you know, they did a different EEG because they wanted to see if there was any more seizures going on. So what ended up being was I did have a seizure that showed up on the original EEG. And then also they're concerned if there's another mass growing. Now, when you have this glioblastoma and you have a mass, majority of the time, if it's going to be a recurrence, it's going to hit the same area where you had your last one. So that did show something there. They, you know, again, they're not sure. That's why they're doing all these tests. Another possibility is they called it see, now my mind has gone blank. Radiation something or another thing. And I think it could be that. So I finally got discharged on Friday. Now today is what? Today's Monday. Got discharged on Friday afternoon. They originally said the second EEG I was having that I would be on that monitor for 24 hours. And all I kept saying is, I mean, I want to go home. I mean, I came to the hospital with whatever I was wearing. I mean, I didn't even have as much as a toothbrush, change of underwear, like nothing. When I did go for the MRI, the first time I did not realize the pants I had on had a zipper, a metal zipper. And on my chest, I had leads on there from the testing. So, I mean, so when I went for this other MRI, which was more extensive, I said to the woman, I go, you know what I realized? You know, because at the time, who's thinking, right? Do you have any metal on you? No, I don't have no metal on me, you know? And she goes, oh, you can't, you know, have that. She goes, well, didn't you feel them getting hot? And I said, nope. So they gave me a pair of hospital scrubs, pants, just the pants. So I ended up, I said, you know, she goes, well, you know, go ahead, you can just keep them. Because I think my other pants probably would have walked right off of me and right out of the hospital. So I ended up coming home with them. But I have to tell you, I came home, so now I'm on, changed my meds. They put me on, let me see, I'm chatting away here. I want to make sure these are going to be about the same size. Can't really tell. They put me on a steroid medication. They put me on seizure medication, Pepcid. You know, for all of that. I'm going to back up this and I want to make sure. Size wise, how we're at here. Whoops. Okay, I need a little bit more. So when I came home, I was feeling pretty good. The first thing I did was right in the shower. Oh my gosh, there's nothing like a nice shower, fresh, clean clothes. And then I had this burst of energy. I was moving furniture around. I was mopping the floor. I was washing all the dog crate out. I was washing all her blankets. I was doing all this crazy stuff because steroids, if you've been on steroids, you know what I'm talking about. It just makes you kind of crazy. It just gives you this burst of energy. I'm going to go back now. Maybe I'm long. Maybe it's good enough here. Gives you this burst of energy that, you know. So, yeah, that looks good. Okay. So let me cut this. And, you know, I didn't sleep good that night. Friday night did not sleep well. And Saturday I was having a online class with my stamping, and I was just out of sorts. I'm going to do the edge now, tuck this underneath, just out of sorts totally. Could not find my phone, could not, you know, all this, you know. I'm going to go slow here because the last time how it jammed a little bit. I just was out of it. I'm trying to do the class online through Facebook Live and I can't find nothing. And oh, so after that, I just kind of took a little breather, and the rest of the day was just, it just wasn't good. And, you know, I'm thinking, I don't know if I can continue to stay in my home, you know, and take care of myself. I'm going to go back over it again just to be sure. But anyhow, I ended up Saturday night sleeping really well. Got up Sunday. What am I stuck on here? Oh, the needle. Okay, needle cut. Sunday I ended up feeling much better, and thank goodness. And now today's Monday. I've had multiple phone calls, everyone calling, offering help from, I have a Geisinger plan that is my insurance. And while I was there, I also had them do an ultrasound of my thyroid, because back when I was first diagnosed, they told me that on the scan, it showed, I'm just going to go over this a little bit more. It showed a thyroid mass. So the doctor had written the script, though, for a different hospital that's not covered by my insurance. So while I was at this hospital, I had them do the scan. And they called today, too, and they want me to have a biopsy of that area. So I'll just be waiting for them to call to set that up for me. So, all right, let's see. Oh, yeah, I did pretty good size-wise. Let me move this back. Okay, here they are. Two coasters. Look how cute they are. So what I want to do next is I want to attempt to do some embroidery on the center of that. But that's how you do the rope bowls, aka coasters. Let me trim this. So anyhow, that in a nutshell has been what's been going on in my life. If you've been wondering where have I been, I've been in the hospital Tuesday and was discharged on Friday. So just trying to get everything straightened out. I felt good today. I actually went outside and I did a little bit of trimming on some of the shrubberies around my house. I have this little handheld Black & Decker hedge trimmer, and you charge it, and it's small, but it's enough that I can just trim my lilacs and forsythia on the side of the house. It was really getting bushy. But so that's what I did today, other than answering the telephone for all the different phone calls. I did have an episode today where I did a little bit of cooking yesterday. Even I made the other day hamburgs. I used my microwave. I have this microwave kind of pan thing that's like a grill pan. And I had one left, and I thought, well, I better have something to eat. The steroids are really giving me an appetite. I have to say that. They're really giving me an appetite. So I had one left, and I was going to have it. And then in the meantime, I started eating it. And then that's when the phone call came from the hospital. And I put it down somewhere. And when I was done, I'm like, well, where did I put that? See, again, where did I put it? I didn't know. So then I looked at Aurora and I thought, I bet she Yeah, I bet I put it on the end table and she probably took it and ate it. Oh well. So I'm telling my daughter, I think the dog ate my hamburger, and I'm so sad because I've been dying for hamburgers, you know. And here, about an hour later, I happen to go in the laundry room, and there it was on the washer, sitting on the plate on the washer. So I blame poor Aurora. I felt so bad that I blamed her for that. So I took her for, oh, I don't go for long walks because I get too tired. I went up and down a few times. I took her for a walk. We sat on the porch, and I apologized to her for blaming her for eating my hamburger, where she really didn't eat the hamburger. But anyhow, so that's what's going on. But I did want to do this video. I did want to, because I know I've been kind of, toying around. I wanted to get back into making rope bowls, but I will attempt. I don't know, today, maybe tomorrow, I will attempt to do a little embroidery on the coaster and see how that works out. And if all works out well, then I will do a video for you to show you how to do it. And like I said, the coaster is done the same way as you would do, oops, I don't want to lose that pin, as you would do the rope bowl. But you would stop at this point, leave your rope still attached, and go ahead and do it. And look, you could even put this in the center of your bowl to support that a little bit more if you wanted to. So even if I did embroidery on here, I could go ahead and attach that in there, because I'm just worried this isn't like a lot of thickness to go through with the embroidery machine if you were gonna, stitch through both of these. But if you're just going to stitch through the bottom half, I would think it'd be okay, but we will see. So hopefully I will be back to share with you. Now I still have enough rope here, I believe, that I probably can get another coaster out of that. So if that kind of helps you with how much you can get out of one, I'm going to make another coaster after I stop this video. So anyhow, folks, thank you all so much. Everyone has just been, throughout this whole illness of mine, has been the prayers, the thoughts, the well wishes. Oh my gosh, I'm just overwhelmed and so happy to hear that there are such wonderful people out there. With this, with not driving, I feel a lot that I'm a captive in my own home because I can't really go anywhere. I'm pretty much just stuck here. So I did find out happily today that through my insurance, there is a ride program that they had just started, where 4 times a month you can get a ride to go, like, to the grocery store, to the store. They will give you a ride somewhere other than a doctor appointment, and I'm really excited about that because I have to have everything delivered to the house because I can't get, or someone has to pick things up for me. So I'm excited to get that going. I'm a little nervous because I'm nervous about being out and if that episode hits me again. So I'm not going to think about that. I'm just gonna, think positive thoughts. But everyone, I just want to thank you all. The social media has really helped me immensely, by having feeling like I have contact with people on the outside world. Between my stamping, my Facebook lives, and my video, my YouTube channel, it just has been the best thing that is available for me right now. And I just want to take this moment to thank you all so very much for helping me out. And I hope you enjoyed this video. I look forward to doing more videos because I really do enjoy sharing things that I learn. I'm not an expert by any means, but I do enjoy crafting. It's my therapy. I look at it, it's my therapy. And I want to thank you all again. So I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day. And until next time, happy stitching. Bye for now.